First of all, it's important to understand the difference between a centralized and a decentralized system. And it's very simple, actually. A centralized system holds the authority is held by a single node, and there is a single point failure. And whenever some disputes arise, there is a cost of settling them. There's a cost of resolving them. Whereas you can see as distributed is actually a superset of distributed and decentralized. So a decentralized system can go on to have many other centralized hubs, and distributed protocol can be something like Git, something like that. Yeah. So a decentralized system just distributes its authority over to several nodes, and you can go on to have your centralized hubs or whatever way you like. But this is very abstract. We'll move on to see the specifics of these protocols. A distributed ledger technology is something that we're going to discuss today. A blockchain is one of a DLT. There are other DLTs too. We're going to see what a blockchain is, but a superset of these technologies is a distributed ledger technology. A ledger is nothing but a database which holds a record of all the transactions that have happened in the system. Now, generally in any normal centralized system, all the transactions that have happened are stored at one place, right? We go to YouTube, we go to Facebook, we see the number of likes, and we know that that number is actually stored with Facebook or with Google's servers. And we have actually no way of verifying that number. So we just trust the authority in that case. And in that case, it's not that high stakes either. But when it comes to other systems like economy and something which you need to know whether the value is that or not, you need to distribute the ledger among all the participants, so that there is no single source of truth. You're not trusting anyone. So in such a system, you need everyone to agree and come on the same page, right? So how do we do that? We do that by consensus algorithms. So we're gonna look at a couple of consensus algorithms today of how consensus is maintained among such systems. But it's important to understand that in such a system, all the participants have a copy of the ledger. So it's like if Facebook was decentralized, then all of us would have a copy of entire Facebook's database. And for example, Bitcoin, everyone who participates in Bitcoin, everyone who has a node on the Bitcoin network, every participant has a copy of the entire database of Bitcoin. That means all the transactions that have happened to date on Bitcoin, that ledger is with everyone. So it's quite public, but there are some things called as a private blockchain. So later on in the session, we're going to see what a public and private blockchain is. But right now, another important property of such a ledger is it's immutable. So when everyone has a copy, everyone can make changes and have their own version also. But these ledgers are immune to that. These ledgers can't be mutated. So once a transaction has happened on the blockchain, it has happened, it can't be changed. So some cryptographic concepts are important to understand. So we maintain all these constraints like immutable and irreversible. But how do we do that? We have to have some mathematics behind it. So hash functions are such a mathematical tool that help us, first of all, anonymize the message and make it irreversible. So as you can see, any input given into a cryptographic hash function will give us a fixed length output. So no matter what the length of the input is. By the way, if you guys have any question, just put it in the chat or just speak up, and we can make this interactive also, because right now it feels like I'm talking to a wall. So just if you have any question at any point, just put it in the chat or speak up. Okay. Cool. So we have some examples of hash functions is SHA-256, SHA-512. For example, SHA-256 will give you a hash output of 256 bits. And no matter if you input a whole book or just a tweet of several characters, it will give you a fixed output. And if you end up, for example, in this example, you just change one letter and the hash output that you get is completely different. So this is helpful. Later on, we'll see in proof of work consensus algorithm that no matter what input you give, the input should be indiscernible from the output. Another concept that is necessary to look at is asymmetric cryptography. So using algorithms such as RSA or ECDSA and such, you can generate a pair of keys. So key is just a number. A pair of keys means just a pair of numbers, two numbers, such that if you encrypt a message with the public key, you will be able to decrypt with it with just the private key, and vice versa. So once you have this public key and private key pair, you just distribute the public key amongst everyone who has participated in the network, and you keep the private key with you. So anyone who encrypts a message with your public key, only you will be able to see it, because only you will be able to decrypt it with your private key. So this is one of the base concepts, one of the very basic things that runs the blockchain, or that runs any identity service, that runs a lot of identity-related services on the internet, a public key, private key pair. Signature is one of the concepts that also uses this pair. So if you encrypt some message with your private key, that is called as signing. So you have signed the message, and anyone who has your public key can decrypt it and read it and be sure that only you have sent the message. Only you could have signed it with your private key, because only you have the private key. So there are two uses. One, which you can see in the diagram, just encrypting with a public key and decrypting with a private key to ensure that only Alice sees the message and no one else. The other use is signing to prove to someone that only you have made the message and no one else. So signing and encrypting, which it will be demonstrated here, that how it can be used to create a chain of transactions. Now we are coming closer and closer to blockchain. So in 2009, Satoshi Nakamoto wrote a paper. Let's look at it, in fact. So this is the paper. I don't think you can see my screen, so let me just share that screen also. Cool, you guys should be able to see the paper, right? Bitcoin.pdf.
Yes.
Okay. So this is the original paper that started it all. So I recommend you guys give this paper a read. It basically describes what a blockchain is, and later on, based on this, a lot of blockchains have emerged. But this was original what started it all in 2009. So it has been 10 years. But is the part that I took from it, because this describes a transaction chain. So it says that let us have a coin, and let's say it belongs to owner one. Okay, it belongs to owner one, and owner one wants to transfer it to owner two. So what will it do? It will just take that, digitally signing the hash of the previous transaction and public key of the next owner. So it will take the hash of the previous transaction. Now, what's a transaction? A transaction just says, okay, transferring of coin from an address to an address and the value. So coin can have any value. So I'm transferring some value from one address to another address. So we take that transaction's hash, and now we know what a hash function is. And we take the next owner's public key. Okay, so look at here, owner one wants to transfer it to owner two. So it took owner two's public key, took the hash of this entire transaction, and it signed it with its own private key. Now we know what a signature is also. So when we sign it with owner one's private key, we get a signature. So now this signature is basically signing a message that says, okay, this much coin has been transferred from owner one to owner two. And anyone who has owner one's public key can decrypt and read it and be sure that only owner one was able to sign it, because only owner one has the private key. So this goes on like this. And the hash of the previous transaction is very important to have, because then everyone will is on the same page and says, okay, I have the latest hash as this value, and you also have that value, so we have followed the same chain. If you were to follow a different chain of transactions, then obviously your hash will be different. So that way we can verify whether you have been following the same transaction history. Now we know that any value change within a transaction will lead to a completely different output. That we know from the previous slide. So that's how you maintain a chain of transaction without any change, because any change will lead to a different hash value. Now there are other ways to make this constraint even more, like enforce this even more. So we'll look at that. But basically, this is, in an ideal world, this will be the transaction chain algorithm without any blocks and without any proof of work and mining and everything. But it's not an ideal world. It's we need to add some more constraints. We'll look at them later on. But I hope till now everyone is clear with this concept, a chain of transactions which goes on signing. If any question, just let me know. Okay, there is some interesting message. Okay, there is a question about the Genesis block. It look, and there is a message from Rajesh. Okay, first let me talk about the Genesis block. So the first block is called a Genesis block. We will look at that quite visually. I have a visual demo for you to look at that. So hopefully that will make things clear. I was not quite able to understand Rajesh's question. So if you can speak up and maybe we can talk.
Yes, my voice is audible.
Yeah.
Yeah, sir. Thanks a lot. So, like, I heard that, like, Bitcoin doesn't leave any money trail behind. It's like we consider normal financial transaction. If we do a bank transaction, then we can track, like, how money flows. But in case of Bitcoin, there's no money trail left behind. That's why we said, like, hackers use it. We cannot see, like, from where Bitcoin goes and all those.
Yeah, so when they say that Bitcoin leaves no trail behind, that's because there is no real world identity linked with your Bitcoin address. So you are quite anonymous on the Bitcoin network. So you can have multiple accounts, you can distribute your funds across those accounts, and no one will really know who that address belongs to. So right now, if you go on the Or let's go to Etherscan.
So it means if I steal someone Bitcoin, that no one can track it, like whether it belongs to me or not.
Yeah, you can't track who it belongs to. So right now we are on Etherscan.io. So it's not the Bitcoin blockchain, but it's Ethereum blockchain, and transactions are happening as we speak on this blockchain. And as you can see, these are the transactions that are coming up like 16 seconds ago. And so it's from an address to an address, and the value is certain Ethereum. But the thing is, you can't look at this address and say who it belongs to in real world. So there is no link. Like, it's just a public key private key pair. And so if you are a hacker, or if you are any like journalist who wants to hide from the government, if you are any activist who wants to hide their financial transactions, you can make transactions on the blockchain, and basically your address is your identity. So that's how you remain anonymous. Yeah.
Got it. Thanks.
Cool. Yeah. Cool. Let me know if like I'm not able to get the notification if you have put any messages in the chat. So just let me know. That's fine also. Cool. So coming to the Genesis block and what a block looks like, and like how do we make sense of all this? Visual is the best way. So this Anders.com is a very good open source project, which basically there are a certain number of demos here. So okay, just look at this. This is a block, okay, and this is the hash of the block. So any data that goes into it, it will just calculate a hash of it.